The fermented food thing was a huge hit, such a huge hit. There was a subset of people getting a little higher inflammation from the fiber. Dietary manipulation to optimize the microbiome to lower inflammation.
Food intolerances are on the rise, and a lot of people report difficulties with fiber-rich foods. I recently got to discuss this with Dr. Christopher Gardner. His lab at Stanford has been studying human nutrition for decades, and they recently published a groundbreaking study looking at the effect of fiber and fermented foods on health. We also covered a number of possible solutions and strategies for people who have trouble digesting fiber-rich foods. Here's our conversation.
There was a study that you published with the Sonnenberg lab, which touched on this individual diversity and the intolerances, which is a big topic now, precisely because some people don't do well on diets that are supposed to be great. Yeah. And so you guys published this seminal paper on fiber intolerance. Can you briefly go over what you found and kind of the takeaways?
Yeah, this one was super fun because when we got into it, the Sonnenbergs had been working with mice for decades. And everything they did to them, drugs and surgeries and notobiotic germ-free mice, diet was the lever that was affecting the microbiome in a positive way. And they were terrified of humans because they know humans cancel and reschedule and they're rude on the phone sometimes. And my group hates poop because it's icky and it smells bad. And so like neither of us wanted to do the other thing. But at a conference one time, we spoke back to back and just like star-crossed lovers after our talks, we said, I want to work with you. No, I want to work with you. And it's like two pieces of the amulet. It's like, hey, you do the poop and you recruit the people. And in a first big study that we did with them that just got published in Cell last year, we were talking about, so let's do prebiotics and probiotics. Let's do fiber-rich foods and fermented foods. And it was kind of funny because Justin was humoring me. He said, you know, we've been doing fermented food stuff with the mice and not much was happening. And he was pretty sure it was all about fiber. And he was just going to humor me because he was happy we were going to recruit the humans. And we got 18 people to eat as much fiber as humanly possible and 18 people to eat as many servings of fermented food as humanly possible. So let's stop again here and go back to sort of that diet fits idea. How much fiber? How much fermented food? What is high? And so we took people, you got excluded if you were eating a lot of fiber because there wouldn't be as much room for improvement. So you're supposed to be getting no more than 20 grams a day. And we were going to try to double it to 40 or higher. If you could go higher. And for the fermented food group, almost no one was eating fermented food in the Bay Area. So that was easy. And we sat around the table thinking, you know, the bigger of a perturbation you make, the more likely you're to see a response. So serving or two a day, that seems trivial. Three or four, what about six? What about six servings? Oh my God, that sounds ambitious. Except think about sauerkraut and kimchi, which are two of the key foods that we were asking them to eat, half a cup, like 50 calories or less. So we actually put together a whole bunch of different combinations of six servings of fermented food, and the average caloric intake was 300 calories. Six servings a day. If you're eating an 1800 calorie diet, that's a sixth of your calories. It's not like half your day or all your food. It's not six meals. It's six servings. And the fermented food people did get up to five or six servings a day and maintained it for 6 weeks. The fiber folk got up to 40 or more grams of fiber a day and maintained it. Mm-hmm. And I'll go off on the fiber because that's actually, let me do the fermented first because that was really easy. Pretty much across the board, their microbial diversity increased. Fascinatingly, it wasn't just the bugs in the foods they were eating. We did a whole little thing on the side to show that by changing the milieu of the environment in the colon, new species appeared that maybe were there hanging out and were just at subdetectable levels. Mm. Anyway, the diversity increased and we looked at inflammatory markers and 20 different inflammatory markers went down and decreased. So the fermented food thing was a huge hit, such a huge hit that when I handed him the data, Justin called me up and said, are you sure you didn't mismatch the coding? Is that the fermented? Because I think you gave me the fiber instead of no, double check. That was a fermented. So we went back to the fiber and looked. Nothing was really going on average. I thought, this is wow, this is pretty backward because I really thought fiber was going to do it and fermented wasn't. Let's look at a little closer at the fiber, and had this amazing postdoc, Hannah Wostick, and another one, Gabrielle Frejadakis, who's now at UCSF. And I think Hannah started her own business. They looked sort of at what was the baseline diversity of the microbiome. And they also looked in the stool samples to see what kind of fiber was coming out the other end that wasn't chewed up as fuel by the bacteria. Mm. And so what they found was there was a subset of people who are getting getting a little higher inflammation from the fiber. And the ones who did that were the ones who had low microbial diversity and were churning out lots of fiber in their stool, as if to say, oh man, fire hose of fiber coming down the pipes. Whoa, slow that down. I don't have the capacity to handle this. Just send it through, send it. Oh my God, inflammation, right? Whereas another group that had higher microbial diversity handled that better. They didn't have as much fiber coming out in their stool because they were chewing it up for fuel, and they lowered their inflammation. But when you put the two together, it canceled.
Mm-hmm. The average
looked like nothing was going on. So the Sonnenbergs did a beautiful job sort of framing this as, you know, if you want something foundational, people don't eat a lot of fermented food. And we saw very consistent benefits across the 18 people who did this. Across the 18 people who did fiber, it appeared we had nothing, but this looks like a level of personalization with a depleted baseline microbiome that had difficulty with a high fiber diet. And So maybe something like that needs to ramp up much slower, or maybe never get there, or maybe have fermented food first and increase their diversity. And that's actually one of the designs we have right now. So we have one group doing fiber, one fermented food, one both, and one neither. Maybe if you're doing them both, maybe you could increase your diversity with the fermented food and then have a greater capacity to handle the fiber that's coming. So these are answers we don't have, but a tantalizingly fun study to do and see the responses of these two different groups around, if you don't mind my ending on this particular conversation on this note, inflammation, which is a hot topic, but we have crappy metrics. Mm-hmm. We have hundreds of inflammatory markers. Is it CRP? Is it IL-6? Is it SICAM1? Is it MCP? Is it, oh my God, I have this huge list of inflammatory markers that I get back from the Human Immune Monitoring Center. And I say, can you just give me a number? Can you tell me, like, Gil's inflammatory status is 52 and mine is 35 and I should aspire to be Gil and to do that? No, I like have hundreds of inflammatory markers with no cutoffs for clinical high or low or normal, like you would get with a lipid or a blood pressure or a glucose. And so that's a very fun field of thinking of this trifecta of dietary manipulation to optimize the microbiome to lower inflammation. So diet's confusing. There's hundreds of microbes in your colon and there are hundreds of inflammatory tests. We need better metrics for inflammation.
Yeah, not to mention the location aspect, because we're measuring inflammation markers in the blood and the serum, but there could be localized inflammation in different regions. The ramping up makes sense. The ramping up of fiber, I think that's pretty standard in gastroenterology when people have these intolerances. It's like a slow incremental increase of specific types of food. And if they're introduced too suddenly, yeah, people oftentimes can't handle it, which a lot of times leads to misunderstandings, particularly on the internet, that people just do these drastic changes and they don't do well on it. And they conclude, oh, these foods are bad for humans then.
Right.
Well, not necessarily. If I go to the gym and I've been sitting on my couch for 10 years and I just put on the maximum weights and I injure myself, it doesn't.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, lifting weights is no good for me. I tried and I'm in horrific pain. Clearly, resistance training is bad for you. No, we have a fantastic gastroenterologist, Sean Spencer, who sees patients and is just doing a world of good playing around with them and, you know, slowly increasing these folks. And he's got people with IBD and IBS and food intolerances. And he's got people coming in, all they eat is chicken and rice. They just, like, that's chicken and rice don't cause any kind of flares of disruption in their GI tract, and they're fine, but they're going crazy. They want something more than chicken and rice. And so he's helping them eat sort of a more fiber-rich plant-based diet by introducing these things and varying it clinically. And hopefully he's going to get some grants funded to follow up on those ideas.